get rugby updates directly to your inbox plus subscribe. Thank you for subscribing. Could not subscribe. Try again later. Invalid email. It was an incredible night at the Liberty Stadium as Swansea City breathed new life into their Premier League survival hopes with a nerve-jangling 1-0 victory over Liverpool. Some 360 days after a win over the same opponents at Anfield sparked an unforeseen turnaround in fortunes, Swansea will be hoping this result is looked back on as a similar landmark in the campaign when all is said and done come mid-May. For new manager Carlos Carvalhal, it is 7 points from 12 in the Premier League. Swansea had taken 13 from the 20 before his arrival. It is 1 defeat in 6 in all competitions and, while no one is getting carried away, there is reason to believe another great escape can be achieved. So what has changed under Carvalhal? On and off the pitch. In such a short time. Building on defensive foundations. The most striking part of the win over Liverpool and the first half against Tottenham came in how Carvalhal, known for preferring attacking football, was prepared to rely on defensive foundations to give his side a platform in the game from which to build. Such an approach is not a million miles away from that which caused such consternation among supporters during the latter stages of Paul Clement's reign. But there are differences. Notably, in recent games there has visibly been more intensity and enthusiasm about Swansea's play. Without the ball, they were less standoffish against Liverpool than they had been against Tottenham. They kept their shape but pressed aggressively and repeatedly when given the chance to harass a red shirt. It would be wrong to say there has been a complete sea change in performances. And it should not be expected, as Carvalhal will need time to get his message across. But there has been a greater edge. Fullbacks urged on. The main difference under Carvalhal has been his willingness and eagerness to urge his full-backs or wing-backs up the field, an approach which almost seems to have caught them by surprise. Mike van der Horn filled in at right-back at Newcastle and appeared genuinely concerned at just how high up the field his manager wanted him. It paid off when his cross set up Jordan Ayew's goal. The 52-year-old has been no different with Martin Olsen, Kyle Naughton, Connor Roberts or Tom Carroll when they have filled the wide defensive roles. He wants them going forward when the opportunity presents itself. The sight of Carvalhal waving them upfield has become a regular feature. He wants that width and is demanding it. Men in the box. The other change has been the amount of men Swansea are ready to commit into the opposition box. This was highlighted by Alan Shearer on Match of the Day following the win over Watford in Carvalhal's first game at the helm. Swansea have lacked quality in the final third for much of the season, but they also rarely committed forward in great numbers. Now it is no surprise to see 3-4 or more white shirts breaking into the box in support of an attack which, as shown at Vicarage Road, can reap considerable dividends. It was less obvious against Liverpool, but the likes of Sam Clucas and Leroy Fair did make the effort to try and provide assistance for Jordan Ayew and Nathan Dyer. Speed of attack. Once Swansea find room in the wide areas, Carvalhal has tried to encourage his players to seek to move the ball forward quickly. A real bugbear for supporters has been the sight of fullbacks or wingbacks receiving the ball in the opposition half but then playing the ball back. That still happens, as it inevitably will at certain stages of games. But Olsen, in particular, has looked to keep the ball moving, while Naughton has also been more assertive. It's not perfect by any means, but there is a greater willingness to take a risk. Positivity. One off-the-field factor which has fed into that greater assertiveness has been Carvalhal's unrelenting positivity. Towards the end of Clement's tenure, his downbeat demeanor fed through to his players. And the former Derby boss was warned by his bosses that his mood was having an impact on those working around him and that he needed to put on a more positive front. Instead, he allowed his frustrations to consume him. most notably his scathing assessment of the defeat at Stoke. Under Carvalhal, players have become accustomed to finding a smiling face greeting them as they come through the doors at Fairwood of a morning. Even play wrestling some players as he encounters them. Enthusiasm, intensity, aggression. Similarly, you don't have to be in Carvalhal's presence long to appreciate his exuberant love for football. He loves to pore over the tactical details and explain them to his players. He lives and breathes the game in a very visible manner. He is an intense individual. He knows what he wants and he's not shy in demanding it and continuing to demand it from his players. He is always wants things done at a higher level. Even if satisfied with what he sees, he will tell the squad we can do it better. It's that enthusiasm that players have highlighted when speaking about their new boss, and it has rubbed off on them and was clear in how they warmed to the task against the likes of Watford, Tottenham and Liverpool. Training. Clement's training was regularly praised by staff and players at Fairwood, and there is no doubt significant strides were made in this area after standards slipped under Francesco Guidolin and Bob Bradley. Carvalhal has looked to continue the intensity of those sessions, and has continued to make life uncomfortable for the players during his sessions by putting them in high tempo and high pressure situations. But he's a little more relaxed and a little less regimented than his predecessor, while still demanding high standards of professionalism. Clement's sessions were demanding with pre-prescribed workloads for players based on their positions. For example, there were set targets for distances covered by each unit during sessions. Carvalhal coaches more by feel, still paying close attention to analysis and data, but is not so reliant on it. Training has been pushed back a little later in the day, but fines remain in place for those who are late for sessions or team meetings, as was the case under Clement. He is understanding but not prepared to give too much ground. He is a friendly character and describes himself as a romantic, but no one should think for one second that he's a soft touch. When one player missed a day of training with illness and then sought an additional day at home, Carvalhal made sure he reported to Fairwood to be assessed and the player took part in the subsequent session. Personal touch. The squad have also appreciated the personal touch and approachable nature of Carvalhal's personality. Jordan Ayew and Sam Clucas, much maligned before his arrival, are among those he has had one-on-one chats with where he affirmed his belief in them while demanding improvements. Their performances have notably stepped up, particularly Ayew, who has been a player rejuvenated, taking the pressure off. Carvalhal's handling of his media duties and his enjoyment of any number of analogies has also caught the attention, be they fish, Formula One or hospital related. His sound bites are a headline writer's dream, but what that also accomplishes is the easing of the heat on his players. Even if he privately leaves them in no doubt as to what he expects from them, it's a diversionary tactic which puts the focus on him, while allowing his squad to zero in on the job at hand. Even when talking about his players, he has made sure to assert the positives. When talking about Clucas and wanting better from the midfielder, Carvalhal also shared how he had wanted to sign the player at Sheffield Wednesday and he knew the former Hull midfielder would soon find form. His ability to amuse and entertain lightens the mood, but it is about far more than that. It's a tactic not too dissimilar from what his compatriot Jose Mourinho has sought to do over the years.